Welcome to this afternoon's Pan-African Thought Leadership Conversation. And we are privileged this afternoon to be addressed by Mr. Vusi Vilakati, who is an ordained minister of religion, and he holds a MA, a master's in biblical and religious studies at the, from the University of Pretoria. He's also has an MPhil in personal and professional leadership at UJ, and is at present a PhD candidate in our program in leadership in performance and change at UJ. His research interests include African consciousness in leadership and coaching, future fit leadership development, and leadership for the economic and social advancement of Africa. So this afternoon, he will address us on African leadership, of course. And I'm intrigued by his argument, which is that African leadership is nothing more or nothing less than the practice of humanity. However, it is for us to rediscover and internalize it. I also would like to welcome Professor Theo Veldsmann, who will facilitate the process, and our panel members, Dr. Sydney Mufamadi, who is the director of the School of Leadership here at UJ, and then Dr. Andrew Johnson, who's on his way. He is the Chief Learning Officer at Eskom. Welcome, everybody, and I hope you're going to enjoy this afternoon.
And I am honored to have this moment. I do hope that, for me, this is a great privilege. I do hope that for you, it's a small gift from myself. When I left home this afternoon, my wife says, if you hang it, at least you have an African shirt, they might clap for the shirt. Friends, I have no claim to have mastered the subject of what African leadership is about. The more I've tried to endeavor to ask the question, is there any concept like African leadership, I have discovered that there might not be actually a concept of African leadership. So what I propose today is some thoughts around what could be done to envisage Africa as a key focus of leadership, as a key focus of engagement and the embodiment of that which seems to become dominant in the life and texture of Africa as a continent. So what I then try and do today is to try and just make a few suggestions. African leadership, rediscovering and internalizing practice of humanity. The concepts are, I think we do need to ask some questions around what has happened to the wealth of research around the concept of Africanness, African consciousness, African renaissance? What has happened to that in translating that to some real practices of humanity in practice as leaders at personal, organizational, and maybe at bigger levels? So I structured the afternoon with a brief introduction. I asked a question in the afternoon, what is African leadership? I ask why African leadership, the need to rediscover the practice of humanity, and how we can refocus the future of African leadership. You take that, I start from the premise that I have implied fluidity to even the concept of African leadership. So my first place is to probably ask the question, what should define or characterize African leadership? Is African leadership defined by its geography? Is it defined by the fact that we stand particular space in the geography of the world? Is it defined by its historical timelines in relation to other contexts or just by itself? Is it defined by the heritage that we claim as to be part of our African heritage from our different ethnicities? Is it defined by the economics of Africa or the economics of Africa in relation to other contexts, or is it defined by just what the balance sheet has to do at the end of the day? Is it defined by culture, the different cultures? If it's defined by culture, we ask the question, which culture, your culture, my culture, his culture, her culture, whoever's culture, which culture should be then important in defining that? Is it defined by race? Is it defined by ethnicity? Is it defined by all of the above? I may infer that Africa is a variable that engages all these subjects with different varying emphases depending on what aspects of African thought you want to work with. If you don't hear anything, probably you'll remember just this slide. I think this captures most of what I might try to infer to in the afternoon. I think the key issue for me is, does leadership advance Africa? Whether you're asking leadership at a small scale, as an individual, do you make a difference in terms of what you do as an African? Does leadership advance Africa in terms of organizations and business? Does leadership advance Africa in terms of what politicians do? Does leadership advance Africa in its stature? So on the last column of that slide is that economic development and human development that I've highlighted. It seems to me that the future demands of us that any development that excludes people is partial development. And so we then have to ask that, what does it mean then to begin to configure development in a holistic nature than probably just economic benefits? Then if you go to the first column towards my left, then we need to ask the questions around the political, economic, and the socio-cultural influences, the national, regional, and global influences. What do we talk about when we talk about the global tilt towards the south, the emergence of places like of entities like BRICS? What does it mean for Africa to relate to the world as an entity and as different countries? What does it mean then in relation to those that invest in Africa? Who are they? What do they demand of Africa? Do their causes advance what Africa may be about? And that whole structure is underpinned by the fact that I am of the assumption that there needs to be some transformative nature of what we do with Africa to deliver some of the key outcomes. Change in the way and the languaging and the practices of what it means to be a leader in Africa. An understanding of innovative strategies, because Africa does seem, in many respects, to be a difficult context to lead in. So what do you do then with leader development and leadership development? What do you do with benchmarking leadership and evaluating leadership? What do you do with understanding context, the climate of leadership in terms of what it is, both as an organizational or at a bigger scale national level? If we were to ask what's the climate of our leadership nationally at the moment, I think many volunteers would offer quick answers to that allusion. What does it mean to the culture that's growing of leadership across Africa? Does it what is best of what we perceive to be African consciousness? What does it mean then at an organizational and an institutional level where you have to then structure specific goals and targets? Do the goals that companies and people set represent what Africa is about? And if they do, to what extent? What can you measure of those? Is African consciousness a good thing to think about, or just a nice thing to have, or just something you can put as part of your tagline, or something more? I've asked all the questions in the same slide, and I work through some of them now a little bit slower. With all the expertise in Africa and all the things that we have come to know about Africa, my question would be, why are some of the African economies still the weakest in the world, with all the expertise and the wealth of what leadership has meant and the investment in terms of leadership development? Why is its political public system still struggling to mature? When a politician is changed in Africa, everything changes, and it seems like we don't seem to find mature systems. Maybe I probably now can say we're not alone in that league, because I think as America has changed leadership, it seems like all systems are tested at the moment. Why is the pace of development and delivery so slow? Is there anything to do with the leadership? Are there high levels of corruption? Are they? Why are they there if they are there? So if Ubuntu and related concepts are central to African human consciousness, why does it seem, in a sense, that we don't seem to have the levels of wealth, we still continue to have the levels of wealth inequality in our context. Why is there no evidence of business and public organizations that display the concept of Ubuntu? Why is there no visible sense that you could say that seems to characterize a strong sense that human beings are more important in that organization than another, and really embed what they think to be central to African thought? Does Ubuntu translate to clear economic and social outcomes? Does it? The development of African leadership, of the leaders of the future, what should be taken into consideration when we do that? How can these values that we think are close to Africa's heart be translated into how we deal with teams and we deal with systems? How do we translate those to business? So these are questions worth asking around Africa and Africa's case and Africa's presence and Africa's leadership. So now, even before I address some of these issues, I want to ask, which Africa are we talking about? Which Africa are we referring to when I talk about Africa? Is it the dark and lost continent that often people refer to? Is it the mysterious other that social anthropologists and philosophers try and inquire into? Is it the chaotic tribal jungle, as some scholars in the 70s and 50s have referred to? Is it a collection of failed states and lost decades of development? Is it a poverty-stricken society that has no hope? Is it a heaven of unruly kleptocrats and canonized thieves? Is it? What do I mean by that? It seems to me, and to many of the literature that you read around African leadership, it seems like the first struggle, that was freedom. Freedom was gained. And then those that gained us freedom, not all of them honored the values that they ascribed to even in the beginning of the journey. It seems that some of those then became the very kleptocrats. Then we started then systems of electing and beginning to work with leaders and understanding now we have our own sons ruling Africa and ruling our businesses. And it seems then, because then we then named the new systems democratic, it seems we canonized some of them as thieves and elected them into positions, and they became, you know, legal thieves to the system. Is that the Africa we're talking about? Or is it the Africa that some people refer to fervently? This is the cradle of humankind, the womb of humanity, that which is the best place in the world to be. Is it that Africa? Is it the Africa that contains 30% of the world's remaining minerals? Is it Africa that liberation heroes and Renaissance activists speak about? Or the Africa that some people would say it's a mosaic of peoples and cultures and a wonderful tapestry of beauty? Is it a cradle of numerous civilizations? So which Africa are we talking about? But there is even beyond that, some emerging narratives that are there before us. Over the last 15 years or even more, there's now been, as the century turned, it's now Africa's turn. Africa is rising. The new scramble for Africa, African Renaissance, and the many undocumented positive stories of leaders in all sectors of life that are tirelessly working to unshackle Africa from its chains. But I still want to think to myself, if that's the case, that's the Africa, or any of those variables define Africa, what would then be African leadership? I want to briefly say, African leadership takes into cognizance Africa's traditional, current, and modern wisdom, and those are the values and attributes that we speak to when we speak around concepts of Ubuntu. Africa is the key tenets of African consciousness, the African Renaissance, and the pan-African dispositions towards emancipation, economic freedom, and the dignity of all people. It is somehow carries the dominant cosmology of Africa that seems that every individual is a custodian of past and the present and the future. But in context, and in the context of this study, I asked that maybe we categorize these things into about three key issues. Africa, if you have to understand the current context, you have to comprehend the historical legacies and the political legacies of Africa. Should we then be addressing the systemic entrenchments of Western forms of knowledge? How do we address that? At the moment, as a country, we're dealing with issues. We throw words around decolonization, a new era of trying to figure out what it means to really educate an African human being and an African child. What should that entail? We also think around congruently appropriating the discourse around a number of things. The discourse around what do we do with the pre-colonial stuff? What do we do with the colonial and the post-colonial narratives? Should we throw all that away? Should we keep those? If we keep them, how do we relate to them? There's a need for us to clarify that. We do need to then deal with the geoeconomic and economic shifts that are happening even now. The fact that Africa is now having an aggressive move of Asia and other parts of the world, what does that mean for the world of work, the world of business? Is Africa able to articulate a stance in a way that prioritizes African priorities in a way that's helpful for Africa's children and Africa's future? Does regional coordination work? If it works, how? Does regional coordination and the policies that have come from AU and the regional sectors, are they helping Africa forward in any way? But we do need to address the essential issue, which is often the one that's referred to in common discourse. We do need to address the issue around what's of essence to Africa? What about those things, those colonial moves and tendencies, and even now, post-colonial struggling, the neo-colonial empirical not. What do we do with those that destabilize Africa, erode Africa's consciousness, and a systematic denial of African agency in many sectors of her existence in relation to the globe? So we then ask then the question, how do investors relate if they were to take us seriously as Africans? That's a long way of trying to say just a simple statement that I suggest might be a working way of thinking about Africa. I suggest African leadership is intentionally Africa-centered and focused, dynamically understands the complexity and connectedness of its historical, current, and future needs of the African context. By that, I probably mean something that's very simpler even. It is leadership in Africa. If it's not in Africa, it's leadership for Africa or within Africa, about Africa, centered in Africa, focused on Africa, on Africa's priorities and its future requirements. So it abstracts it from the traditional narrative of just making African leadership about African consciousness as a cultural construct. It abstracts it to include all the three variables that I've referred to. So rediscovering African humanity, it is to then try and figure out what are the deposits from each of these aspects of our life together. What key philosophical concepts, which I think in my reading, they seem to be spread across the continent. There are some concepts that come from Southern Africa, Eastern Africa, Central Africa, and West Africa, and they seem to move towards the same concept of prioritizing humanity as a key factor in any discourse of engagement, whether economic or any other. So it does seem to me that the human construct is a core construct in our thinking as Africans. And if that's the case, why are there so much disparities in every aspect of our life? And we Africans seem to believe that that's central to us. But how is it that we don't translate that? A scholar that used to be part of this university at a point in time, I think moved on at Vusi Kumede, said, I think to begin to engage Africa's future, we need to begin to think about thought leadership. And his understanding of thought leadership is, thought leadership would be then to say, how do we lead in this time, in a sense that makes Africa break through the mold of all the historical categories and begins to prioritize Africa as a new way? How do we become critical of the historical deposits of Western thought, our own consciousness? How do we become a little bit more engaged beyond just that? And he says thought liberation. We do need to deal with the issue of thought liberation, which is decolonization. What is decolonization? I have no clue what decolonization is. But maybe if we probably look at decolonization and the future, it might be to begin to think around what does it mean to then train an African that's well vested in what Africa is about and understands it and understands the philosophies at play in Africa, the dynamics of African economies, the dynamics of African culture, rather than using North American literature prior to beginning to then say, is there something that's written in Africa about Africa? So which makes me celebrate this wonderful book that Prof. Dio and Dr. Johnson have written, The Leadership Perspective. It's a celebration of our own gifts as African leaders. Critical consciousness. When you get these statistics, when you get all this demographic data that you receive from any sector, whether it's world organizations, are you critical enough of that to nuance it towards Africa's priorities? So, and these are the common values that have been ascribed to African thought. But essentially, it is a consultative dialogue, way of planning and decision making and consensus building. I'm not so sure how consultative is our current leadership at the moment in terms of dialogue. I'm not so sure if they do consult, who do they consult? They do consult, at what time of the day do they consult? Do they consult them in the morning? Do they consult them at midnight? And who is they that they consult? But I think if you look at each of these concepts, they are key. Indaba, Lihutla, Dare from the Shona, Kundla from Swazi, and Imbizo from all these concepts have this motif that carries in it, within itself, the importance of consensus building and dialogue that is widening in its nature. So I suggest this slide as a way of beginning to think about a framework. It is probably a way of trying to say we need to think about training leaders that live within a circle where there is Africa's priorities as a major component of that discourse. When you've done that, you then have to then think not only just of African priorities, you then have to think about what's the informing philosophy that's key to Africa's discourse. And then what are the national, local, and global tides that seem to influence our current experience. And I do think that's central to what might begin to be helping Africa's leaders to think deeply about where they stand in terms of their positionality, where they stand when they walk into discourses with multinationals, where they stand when they take their groups on strategy meetings, where they stand when they train and begin to work with teams and organizational strategies, or when even they converse with, I think I've moved too quick. Then it does also take into cognizance those three poles that I have put in there around the whole concept of leadership development. Leadership development, I think we have come to understand that literature suggests that it becomes more organic, more holistic, more integrative, more dynamic in nature. And it should respond to the VUCA. VUCA is a well-known concept now, but I would think so. If it's not well-known, I think that's an assignment for some people to go and think about it. But it becomes a systemic engagement of what reality is about. So when we then think about leadership development, we then need to start by saying, at an individual level, it is training the person to have the scanning and navigating skills to be able to navigate the complexity of the context, the connectedness of all these variables, and as well as integrate those creatively. Then at a team level, you need to think about how do you configure roles, modes of and styles of leadership, and how do you work with even adaptive processes in that construct. At a business and at the organizational level, you need to think about, at the goals level, how do we think about incorporating what's true to Africa? And then how do we align the whole business strategy and processes to begin to respond to that consciousness? How do we then commit ourselves to transformative action that would be a result of that? I then look at that briefly in terms of some specific outcomes. So if then an African leader of the future were to be taken and put on a stand, that person would have to be to have a strong sense of rootedness and membership to context. That person would have to be connected authentically to specifics about what the continent needs and its future requirements. A context responsiveness and a global responsiveness. That person would have to have, I think these skills have been named in a number of documents and places of engagement. So how do we do it? We're in a university. How do we then structure our school of business? What priorities does it have? If we're a university, how do we structure what we train our economists to be? What does it do to our psychologists? What does it do to all these entities? Is Africa a subset into all that we do as universities, or what? What do business schools do? Some business schools come from beyond the continent and come with a very packed program. And then when you say, maybe we need to include a course in Africa, I don't know that many organizations that come from outside Africa that say, yes, let's include a course on African clothes and African stuff. If they do, they probably just append it such that you understand context, you remember you're in Africa as an appendage. What do we do with organizations? And I think I've referred to a number of issues. Are our public entities beginning to respond to these values that we've spoken about so many times? What does it mean to really say batupili, people first, to muntu ngumuntu ngabantu, in the way we structure our public processes? My simple logic is that's a personal interpretation. I grew up in a village. And in the village, there is many kind of functions. But in most of the functions, you would find yourself dancing in a circle with other people. Whether it's a wedding, there would be a time when you hold hands together and you dance. And in the circular dance, one of the things that sometimes would happen is that in the circle, it's a way that connects everybody. So everybody belongs to that system. And once everybody belongs to the system, in that circle, you have an opportunity then to come out of the circle and stand in the center of that circle and dance and show your particular skill and display your ability to be. And as you dance there, then the rest of the group applauds you dancing and recognizes the gift that you are. And when you've danced your life away and you've sweated your life away, then as you recline, somebody else comes in. There's a strong metaphor there for understanding both connectivity, belonging, and personal creativity as part of how you work with developing people. There is also a sense in which some of these functions go up until very late. And as the night grows, the music goes on and on and on, and it's a beautiful, beautiful celebration of life. Maybe you could try it and just get people to dance in your organization together. Really, you could try that and just see who can do a Dwalatsa better, who can do a Chisa better, all these kind of new styles of dances that are out there. Then at an organizational and a business level, I think the key question that we ask is, we know that when money moves, that's the basic thing, it has an impact. Without a degree of forethought, the impact could generally be negative. That's known. And there's been in Africa a whole issue that amounted to a commission about illicit financial, money that goes out of the continent without being accounted for. So if there's no forethought in what really happens about what we do with business and money and organizations, we could land ourselves in problematic places. But would you imagine that if CSI was bigger than just something you cut off your profits, but CSI becomes a covenanted business construct that you would say, whatever this business does, 10% of this business is about responding to society. Would you imagine what that would do to society? Because that then becomes part of core strategy. Does it become an extra to look good for the scorecard. So how do we leverage that? How do we create shared value? And how do we develop suitable leadership that will create the synergies between the personal staff and the team staff and the business constructs, such that at all the levels of our understanding and practice of leadership, we become responsive to Africa's needs? I submit that that would be probably Africa's future when we begin to recognize that fully. I have one more minute, and the last minute I want to use this a quote from Professor Rakuni, and he says, if I had an opportunity of an informal chat with African government leaders sitting in the shade of a tree in my village, I would say to them, excuse me, friends, the way I see it, you are really trying to build the house backwards. The allusion there is, when you look at the ways in which governments structure themselves, we inherited these processes from colonial masters in many instances. Very little of our processes begin from the bottom by understanding the dynamics of community. So the processes and the policies that come from the top, whether it's giving grants or anything like that, if they don't begin by rebuilding the culture of what a society is about, they are suspect from the bottom. And if you begin from the bottom up, you could actually begin to alter what it means to begin to work with African consciousness. I just like those rendezvous. I have no particular reason why I put them there. I just like them. They look beautiful. But they do seem to suggest that you can't make that top notch look good. That top kind of thing there, what do you call that? That center doesn't hold if you don't put the wood right in the big, on when you make the circle, right as you start building from the bottom. That doesn't hold. And if you have to make that top hold, you begin by systematically working and enculturating the bottom and working upwards to discover that which is about Africa in the top. So I like this quote. The great powers of the world may have given the world an industrial and a military look, but the gift still has to come from Africa in giving Africa a more human face. And this one is mine. Often Africa and its business have been viewed by outsiders as a basket case of poverty, corruption, social injustice, and violence, which can only sink into greater depth of misery. Yet at the core of Africa is a world-class perspective on humanity that many others can only hope to emulate. African leadership as a whole must now engage its own dance with Africans to restore the African practice of humanity. I thank you.